Okay. Let's go back and try this over again. Edward is here. Don't know if you can hear me yet, but I can see your name. I see Jeff's name, Jeffrey Jones. Okay, let's see if I can get my share up. And here we go with that. And go from current slide. Okay. Now, do we have anybody back yet? I see Tarsha, Edward, and Jeffrey Jones, Jeff Jones. We had Kurt, but he's not back yet. Oh, there you are. Gotcha. And we had Jose before. Is he back? Jose's not back. So how many do you see? I don't see this because I've got so many things open. I have Tarsha, Jeff, Kurt, Edward, and Jose, but you say Jose's not back. Is anyone else listed?
Jose is here.
What's that? Who?
Jose.
Jose's here. Fantastic. Got you. So I've got everybody back that was here before, right? Anyone new? Say again, four of you? One, two, three, four. I see five listed. I see Tarsha, Jeff, we got Kurt, Edward, and Jose. Anyone whose name I didn't call? Okay. Who?
Jacob.
Jacob? Is that what you said? All right. Jacob Dove, I take it, right? Is that the right Jacob? Or Jacob Porte? Which Jacob is it?
Jacob Porte.
Oh, Porte. Sorry about that.
I guess can anyone hear me?
Who is that?
That's Jacob. It's Jacob Porte.
Okay, I got Jacob Porte, but Jacob Dove is not here yet. Is that correct? Anybody? Jacob Dove? Don't have him yet? Nobody? Okay. Not sure about Jacob Dove. Okay. So I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Is that how many you're showing besides me?
Yes.
Okay. All right. First, I'm sorry about the delay, but I could not get my DVD to open. I had to shut down the whole computer, and it took a long time to shut down. So I've had it running for days now because over last week, it got so it wouldn't boot off, and we have to work at it, finally get it to boot off. So finally we said, we're going to leave it running because otherwise we may not get it started again. Well, this time it got tired of running, and I had to shut it down. So I guess it had to clear its whatever. All right. Wanted to go. Any questions? Okay. Wanted to make a couple of announcements. I'm guessing all of you have heard now we are not coming back to school this term. Did y'all hear that? Yay or nay?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I thought everybody probably had gotten that word. Did you also get the word that we're not going back to campus in the summer? Now, you automotive students, you don't care, do you? Okay. But we will be running courses, but they'll all be virtual courses. Now, those that are already online courses, yeah, those will stay online. But these, we'll keep running our courses just like we're doing this one now. Virtual classrooms, just as if we were in the classroom, but we're going to be at our various locations, homes or wherever. So everybody had heard that or not? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So any questions about any of that? Okay. So I guess where we're left off now, who was it? It was Jeff who was asking me the question about the not being able to get to the labs. Is Jeff here? I saw your name on the screen when I first pulled it up, but I haven't heard from you. Is Jeff Jones here? Do y'all see him on the screen?
He's still here.
Okay, can you hear me, Jeff? Does anyone have any way to rattle his cage or anything? You got him?
Yeah, I'm on here.
Okay, Jeff's here? Okay, I know I was distracted trying to get my other thing up. And I was trying to think of anything else that I can do there. Can any of you, okay, Jeff, where are you physically located, Alabama or somewhere else?
I'm in Tuscaloosa.
Where, Tuscaloosa?
Tuscaloosa, yeah.
Okay. I was trying to think if y'all could, okay, let me get this straight. Number one, you can't, receive my emails too, is that right? Okay. I wonder, have you gotten emails from any of the other guys here or gals?
No.
Because I was wondering if I could send them a copy of it and then forward it on to you or something like that. But you don't know if you can communicate with them either, huh? Who is it you said you had been able to communicate with by emails? Miss Albright?
I don't hardly ever send emails, but I've received them.
Okay, I can barely hear you. Okay. All right. Now, when you say mass emails, are you talking about the things that I send on Blackboard?
No, I'm talking about the emails from, like, the college.
Okay. You do get the emails from the college or you don't?
I do.
You do. But you don't get individual emails?
Right.
Okay. Are you able to log into Blackboard okay? Okay, do you see my messages from Blackboard?
Yes.
You do see those?
Yes.
Okay, so if I communicate to you through those messages rather than through your regular email, you think you'll get those then?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so what I'll do, I'll try to find the email that I sent to you. And now, how did you know about the Java thing anyway? Did you not get that email, or?
No, I didn't get that email. I asked Ed. Edward told me.
Oh, I see. Okay. Okay. I was trying to think. Edward, have you communicated with him through email?
Text.
Or only through text messages? Okay. Yes, try sometime to do an email with him and see if your email will connect to his, but I doubt if it will, but we'll try that. What I'll try to do is find that email that I sent to you and redo that through the Blackboard message. And we'll see if we can figure it out that way. And at the same time, those same people will be the people who can maybe figure out what's going on with your email as well. And they may be connected. I don't know. Okay.
Can I give you my, just my regular email address? Because my Yahoo address works.
Okay, you have another email address?
Yes, sir, my personal email.
Okay. Hold on just a minute. Let me get that from you. You don't mind giving it over the air here? Because these are some pretty shady characters listening in.
It's J.T. Jones.
J.T. Jones? 2016 at what?
Yahoo.com.
Spell that.
Y-A-H-O-O.
Oh, Yahoo. Okay. Yahoo.com. Okay. JT Jones 2016 at Yahoo.com.
Yes.
Okay. And I believe I just see. I can't see your whole face, but is it Kaya? No. Who is it?
It's Kaya.
I thought so. Okay. I thought whoever it was said no. Okay. Has anyone else come on board since you haven't heard me acknowledge your name? All right. Okay. So we're late getting started because I've had computer problems, and then we've been trying to solve a computer problem of Jeff's. So I will. What's that? Eric, fantastic. I was wondering where you were. So, Eric, you're here. Anybody else?
Mr. Father, Brianna Davis here.
Brianna, excellent. It's been a long time. Okay. Any others? So maybe there's a reason we're starting late. Okay. Glad that y'all are here. Now, for those who just came in, I guess you've heard this campus will not be open the rest of the spring. Did you hear that? Oh, yeah. So disappointed, I guess. Okay, let me rephrase that. For classes, if you have to get something from campus, you can contact campus security, arrange a day and a time when they can do it, and they can let you in for whatever it is you need to pick up and leave. But you have to maintain social distance, all that kind of stuff, but don't plan to be on campus long. But if you have to get something, I think you can do it, you have to go through campus security. And I'm sure you can find their number on the college website. Okay. The other bit of news, and I know the automotive students could care less on this, the campus will not be open this summer either. But we are running all of our classes just like this class. We're going to be running everything, what they're calling virtual classrooms, just like this is. There will be no on-campus classes, but there will be these virtual classes. Now, if you're in an online class, a pure online class, those will still be running too. But most of the classes will be running just like this, a virtual class. Okay, let me move this up here. You probably can't see what I'm doing, but that gets out of my way. All right. Are there any questions on any of this? I hope that we can get Jeff's things straightened out. Any others having difficulty or problems or issues? Was there anything? Nothing? Okay. All right. Where we left off last time, we had just started chapter 3, which is energy. Okay. The last slide we did was this one. I think we hit it all. I don't believe there was anything else to do with that one. And so in your text, we are going to work. And I'm going to have to turn on a light. Today is so overcast that I've had to use a light all day. Does that mess up too much glare or anything? Shining off my bald head. No, okay. Didn't want to blind anybody. Okay, 3.1 is work, and that's where we're going to be starting today then. Let's just go a quick review of what we're going to do today. We're going to get as far as we can in Chapter 3 up until 5:45. I'm sorry, 3:45. At 3:45, we're going to stop, and we're going to do the last lab from Chapter 2. This is the force lab, okay? And again, that's going to be one of these using the lab simulation. And Jeff, see if you can follow it on it, and we're going to go step through step and let me know when that falls apart. But that's going to be starting at 3:45. I hope the lab won't take that long. It's fairly, did everyone get the lab? I sent it last night. Were you able to print it off?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
If you did, that's a good thing, because you can do some of the lab as we're talking through it. You may have to go back and finish up details later, but you can do some of it perhaps most of it, just as we go through the lab together. But then you'll be able to do. And Jeff, you'll be able to watch it on the screen and maybe be able to do your lab that way. Were you able to print yours off?
Yes.
You were? Okay. So you might be able to do the lab that way. Okay?
I just need to scan it to you.
What's that? Yes, and then when you're through with the lab or with a test or with anything else, here's what you can do. I've actually had some people, now that I'm doing the test in Word, I've actually had some people pull off the test, answer the questions in Word, and then send it back to me as a Word document, as attachment to an email or as an attachment to a message on Blackboard, either way. But if you can't do that, if you're printing it off and writing your answer, then scan it if you have a scanner. If you don't, take a picture of it with your smartphone. Either way, then you either email it to me through email or send it to me as an attachment on a message. Okay? Does that answer all the possibilities there? Yes?
Yes.
Okay. Did that answer your question too?
Yes.
And that refers to the labs as well. Those you're almost always going to have to print off. However, this one that I did in Word, if you wanted to type the answers that way and send it back to me in Word, that will work too. However I get it to me. Okay? Now, I was trying to think if there's any way that any of you can, if you could forward the link to Jeff, if he could get it that way, if he can't get it another way. I don't know. Try and see if there's anything like that you can figure out. All right. Any more questions on that? That's what we're going to be doing today. Now, as soon as I can get off the session today, I have another session that starts at 3 o'clock. I mean, 4 o'clock. I'm not going to make it on time, but whenever I can finish, we finish with the lab, I'll be getting off. Y'all can keep working on it. But I've got to get off because I've got another meeting at 4 o'clock. But I told him I'd be late if I made it at all. Okay, then I've got another one this evening at 6. So it's going to be a while before I get around to checking messages, checking emails, checking anything, if anyone's turned in anything recently. I know Tarsha turned in something this morning. I don't know when I'm going to get to do it, but I'll get to it as soon as I can. All right, ready to go with work? Ready to get to work? Okay, let's do it. Definition of work. It's a product of the applied force and the parallel distance through which the force acts. Now, that's a rather strange way of phrasing something, but I don't know if you can see this. If I stand up here, can y'all see my chair here?
No.
No, you can't? No.
No.
You cannot? Okay, I thought I could do a demonstration with that, but it's probably not good enough. It's a black chair, so it's probably not showing up too well. What it was doing, when I'm pushing on the chair, that's a force. Now, if I'm pushing down on the chair, okay, that force isn't doing anything, okay? But if I'm pushing at an angle, then the chair moves. And that's because work is the product of the applied force, the amount that I push, and the parallel distance through which the force acts. What that means, if I'm pushing down, can you see, sort of see my hand like this? At an angle like this, but the chair is moving like that. Can you see that, my hands? Yeah, neck, okay? So pushing like this, but the chair is moving like this, only the component of this push. Remember, a vector has a vertical component and a horizontal component, okay? Only the horizontal component is contributing to the movement of the chair. The vertical component is not. So that's what they mean, the parallel distance through which the force acts. The guy over here picking up the box, he could be sliding the box across the floor, but if he's not picking up on it, he's not doing any work against gravity. Because the weight of the box is pushing downward, his force has to be pulling straight up. So it's only the product of the work that's parallel to the displacement of the box or whatever it is. So the simple definition is work is equal force times the distance. Okay? What units do we use to measure force? Anyone remember that? You'd better. Okay, pounds in the U.S. customary. That's a very good answer for U.S. customary. I thought y'all of you guys were...
Newtons,
absolutely. Okay. All right. So it's either pounds in the U.S. customary system or newtons in the SI system. Now, what's the distance unit, the standard distance for unit in the U.S. customary? I'm standing on one. Foot, absolutely. Okay. How about the standard unit for distance in the SI units?
Meters.
Meter, excellent. Okay. So those are the units for force. Now, usually in the U.S. customary, we say foot pounds. We don't say pound feet. You could, it's no problem, but we usually say foot pounds. You've probably heard it referred that way, haven't you? Okay. On the U.S., in the SI units, a Newton meter has its own name. Does anyone know what that is? A joule. She reads well. Okay. A joule. Now, there I capitalized the J, but I didn't capitalize meter, feet, or pounds. Why did I capitalize joule? Named after somebody. Named after James Prescott Joule. The same way, reason we capitalized Newton. That was named after Sir Isaac Newton. Okay? So that's what a joule is. That's the unit of work is a joule. Okay? And it's a Newton meter. And a Newton, of course, is a kilogram meter per second squared times a meter. Okay, so a joule is a kilogram meter squared per second squared. In the fundamental units, that's what a joule is. Fundamental units, this is what a Newton is. Okay, but in the U.S. customary, it's just foot-pounds. We don't have a special name for it, just foot-pounds. Okay, good deal. So the units of work, and later we'll be using the same units for energy, is a joule. Now here's the part that sometimes will drive people crazy. I'm going to give you an example. I'm looking out at our backyard here, and I can see a retaining wall that my wife and I built shortly after we bought the house. Well, I say shortly, within a year or two or three after we got the house. Our house is on a hill. A lot of things in this neighborhood is on a hill. And they had leveled off the place where the house was built, and they built the house way back in 1930. It's an old house. Thank goodness my wife likes old things. Okay. But the some subsequent owner put an addition in the back of the house. And I'm looking at the roof of that out the back bedroom window here. And in that addition, they built it into the hillside. So that made the back windows really squatty because the soil came right up to the base of the windows, and it made the house look really squatty. But that wasn't what bothered me as much as the fact that the backyard was sloping down toward the back of the house, which meant the water was running into the back of the house. And sure, I'm sure they used fairly quality materials, treated lumber and stuff like this. But in time, that'll leach out. And that I did not think was a good thing to have on the back wall of the house. And I told my wife that. I said, if we wind up getting the house, we need to do something about the backyard because I'll need to do a berm or something to get the water to not flow against the back of the house. And I've also got to get it down so there's no wood-to-ground contact. Anyone know what that causes in the South? If you have wood to ground contact? Say again? Termites. Okay. You can get termites. So I said, I've got to get it down so the boards for the the windows are below the soil line. And my wife said, well, good. I wanted a patio anyway. Not my idea of what the project was going to be. I was just going to do a little berm in the back to get the water away and dig the soil out from the house. She wanted a patio. So that summer, that was actually the first, we bought the house the Halloween after I started work at Western State Technical College. We were then, and I started there in September, and we bought the house at the end of October. We closed on it on Halloween Day. So we that next summer, my only two classes that summer, because summer enrollment was sort of down, was I was teaching the automotive students a special course then called automotive math. Okay, so we had two sections of that, and that was all in the first mini term. We were on quarters back then. They were 10-week quarters, and the automotive students came the first 5 weeks and did the dealership the second 5 weeks. So I was teaching the first year students automotive math that summer, and only for the first 5 weeks. And basically the rest of the time, that was just either 2 or 3 days a week, and the rest of the time I was off. So we started working on digging out the patio. Oh, and it was a major job. And as I dug, if you dug anywhere around the Birmingham, probably Bessemer area too, it's not going to be long before you hit rocks. And I kept hitting rocks. They usually were fairly manageable rocks. Until I got to one near the middle of the patio, and somewhere, and by this time the patio was probably 4 to 5 feet deeper than ground level, and I hit this rock, and I kept trying to go around the rock and going around the rock, and I thought it was never going in. Finally, I couldn't get my arms around it. It was that big, okay? And it went, like I said, at least 3 or 4 feet down, and I hadn't gotten to the bottom yet. And I would dig around, sort of get a pry bar, a cheater bar, and try to get a rock under it as a fulcrum and move that stinking rock. I could not budge it. I would grunt and sweat and say a few words or whatever. I could not get it to move. How much work was I doing? Not a bit. Because if there's no movement, there's no work. No matter how much you say you're grunting and sweating and how much force you're applying, if you don't go a distance, you're doing no work. Okay? Say again? Yeah, you're using energy but doing no work. Now, any displacement perpendicular to the applied work, remember like I said, pushing on the chair? The push that goes downward is not moving the chair at all, so that part of the work was, of the force, was doing no work. So a displacement perpendicular to the applied force, that doesn't make any sense, okay? If you're displacing perpendicular to the applied force, you're still not doing any work. You have to be in the same direction of the motion, okay? So if you're lifting the book from the second shelf to the fourth shelf, the force, the weight of the book is down, the force you exert is up, and you pick it up, what is that, probably a meter, meter and a half, and whatever the mat or the weight, the force of that book in newtons or pounds times the displacement, either in meters or feet, that is the work you're doing. If you move the book from here to there, you're not doing any work because you're not lifting the book. You're not exerting any force against the book. You're just doing a lateral move. That does no work. But one in the direction or counter to the direction of gravity, which is pulling down on the book, that's doing work. Okay. Any questions on that? All right. By the way, we have made it over to page 64, and I think we're ready for our first example. Okay. Example 3.1, top of page 65. How much work is needed? So what we're looking for here is work. That's the unknown. And by the way, if you remember from the last chapter, little w represents weight. That's a force. Capital W represents work. That's work. It's not a force. So don't get them confused. Oh, I do need to say one more thing too. Remember, force and displacement are both vector quantities because direction matters. Now, we're not going into vector math here. That's beyond the scope of this course, but I'll clue you in on something. A force times a displacement, and I intentionally put a dot there to represent the multiplication. That's called a dot product, and a dot product always results in a scalar quantity, not a vector quantity. Work has no direction. Work is just what it is. Energy has no direction. It's just a scalar quantity, like time, like mass, just a scalar quantity. Now, back when I mentioned the term foot-pounds, did that ring a bell with anyone? Has anyone ever used a wrench that was had grades in foot-pounds? Say again? Okay, a torque wrench, is that what you said?
Yes.
Yeah, my hearing's bad and my speaker's a little garbled. That is not work. That's not measuring work. Because then, if you think about that torque wrench, say here's the nut that you're trying to tighten or loosen, and here is the wrench coming out like this. Your force that you put on the wrench, if I can get my screen back, is in this direction, isn't it? Here is the nut up here that you're trying to move or loosen or tighten, but you do this. This is your displacement. This is your force. Those are perpendicular to each other. If we're talking about work, you'd be doing no work. We're not talking about work. What you're talking about there is torque, because a force cross product of a displacement, that's what this represents. That represents torque. And torque is a vector quantity. It is not a scalar quantity. Okay? Where else do you use the term torque? Does anyone think of any? Besides a torque wrench? In what? I can't hear you. I still can't hear. In a car. Okay? You've had the hood up before, right? I'm sure you have. And someone's accelerated the car from the inside. What do you see the engine moving?
It moves side to side,
exactly. Because a torque is perpendicular to the thing. See, the force is in this direction, the displacement in that direction. So the torque is actually perpendicular to both. The torque is coming out. That's what twist the bowl on or off. That's perpendicular to the motion, and that's exactly what your car engine is doing, is torquing. That's why you have the motor mounts in there. If one of those is faulty, that engine's flying out of the box, right? You don't want those to be faulty. Okay, so I wanted to mention that too. Got way off on subject here, but so let me erase this stuff. Okay, re-emphasizing. So if any of you were thinking that wrench was measuring work, no, it was measuring torque, and that's why they call it a torque wrench. Okay, those people who aren't automotive students, that was just all for your listening pleasure. Okay, so how much work, that's what we're looking for, is needed to lift a 5.0 kilogram backpack. So what's that a measure of, 5.0 kilograms? Anybody? That's not weight. Pounds would be weight. Kilogram is?
Mass.
That's mass. Okay? Mass to a shelf 1.0 meters above the floor. Just like we saw before, 1.0 meters. What would that be a measure of?
Distance.
Okay? Now, can anyone answer the question now? How much work is done? to lift that 5-kilogram mass 1 meter off the floor? Or does anyone think we have to do something first? Hint, hint. What's that? A little louder, somebody. Okay, I can't hear. Okay, what was the formula for work? I just had it up there and erased it. Okay, work is a force times a displacement. We got the displacement, that's taken care of. We don't have the force. All we have is a mass. How do we get a force out of a mass? If you remembered before, I had said a newton, what are the units of newton? Does anyone remember? I had it on the board earlier. The units. Kilogram. Anyone remember? Say again. Meters per second squared. You got it. So a force, this is a measure of force, and this is a measure of kilogram is mass, and what's meters per second squared? What's that pedal on the floor to the right? What's that paddle called? Your right foot's on it. Accelerator. This is acceleration. You knew that formula. F equal ma, right? Except now, when we're talking about the force due to weight, what is that acceleration? What acceleration is that? What is pulling down on that? What was it? Book? Backpack. What are you working against?
Gravity.
That's the force due to gravity. Mg, the acceleration due to gravity. Anyone remember what that acceleration was? In the SI units. Help me, somebody. 9.8. So this weight, and that's what I'm going to call it, little w here. Weight is equal to the mass, 5.0 kilograms, times your acceleration due to gravity, 9.8 meters per second squared. And that gives you what? Well, we can just write it all in here if you want to. The work done, that's the capital W, is equal to 5.0 kilograms times 9.8 meters per second squared, there's the force, those things together, times the displacement, which is 1.0 meters. I'm right on my camera right now, okay? So, anyone do that either in your head or do you need a calculator? 49. 49 what? Ladies, okay, it's a kilogram meter squared per second squared. I hope that's what you had. Remember what unit that is? Ladies love to wear them. Joules, exactly. Okay, spelled differently, but okay. All right. Make sense? 49 joules. The book got it right. Good for them. All right, let's go to 3.2. All right, to erase? Yay or nay?
Yes.
Okay. I'm glad y'all are so excited. Okay, how much work, again, we're looking for work, capital W, okay, is required to lift a 50-pound box? What's that a measure of? Anybody? A little louder?
Weight.
That is a weight measurement. That's little w. I hate they are. To keep from confusing them, let's call that our force, okay? It is weight, but let's call it our force, because force is a weight, right? Okay? A 50-pound box vertically, a distance of 2 feet. So they just told that the distance was 2 feet. So how much work is required to lift that box, 50-pound box, 2 feet off the floor? What's the definition? The formula? Work equal? Anybody? Force times displacement, which would be? Anyone already give an answer? Pretty easy math. Anybody? 100 foot-pounds, you got it. 100 foot-pounds. Okay. In between the feet and pounds, I usually put a dot. Sometimes it may look like a dash. That's okay. Just don't think it's a subtraction dash. It's just a dash. Foot-pounds. Okay? The bookkeeper uses a dot. All right. That covers work. Any questions on it? All right. Now, here's a little interlude. And the little interlude, you'll have to flip over one page if you got your books in front of you, page 66 and 67. It's a big, wide, closer look across the page there. This is talking about some simple machines. Okay? The basic premise here, and unfortunately, Kirk's picture is right in the way for me reading this. I know what it's saying, but I'm going to move Kirk. Oh, there you go. Can you see me do that? No, okay. It's only on my computer. Okay. The basic premise here, work out equals work in. Work in equals work out. The amount of work you put in is the amount of work that comes out. Now, we know that's not always true because there's always friction loss. Okay. Never you are 100% efficient. Most of the time, you're nowhere close. But anyway, we'll just say, for now, the basic premise is that. Now, what is work? Force times the displacement. So if the work in is equal to the work out, that's not your workout with the PE class, that's a different one. What work in is the input force times the initial displacement of that caused by that insert is equal to the work out, which is your output force times the output displacement. Okay, we'll just call it DO because it's easier to write. That is your basic formula, work in equal work out. But most of the time we're interested in what is the force, the output force. So let's solve for that by dividing both sides by DO. So that gives output force is equal to your input force times the ratio of your initial displacement divided by your output displacement. Now, here's the general meaning of this. Have any of you ever lifted a car? Yay or nay? With a lift, what do you mean? Hydraulic lift. Well, I don't think you were doing the work. Something else. The machine was pumping the hydraulic fluid and lifting it, weren't you? You just did a switch. Unless you're talking about those that you pump. Is that what you meant?
Yes.
Yes, you have lifted a car then. Or some of you, if you were old enough, you probably remember the old jacks. Car jack, right? I bet you lifted a car with that too, haven't you? Why? Because the force that you applied was pretty small. And the distance over which you did, if you picture how many times you went up and down with your hand there, how far you went up and down, but how far you lifted the car was pretty small, right? Maybe an inch for every 2 or 3 feet you did like this, right? But you still lifted the car because this is what we call the force multiplier. The distance, input distance, applied distance divided by the resultant distance. As long as that's big, yes, you can lift a car. One of the early old scientists who dealt with this was a guy named Archimedes. And he has a fairly famous saying that, give me a lever long enough and a fulcrum to put it on, and I could move the world. Okay? Of course, he'd have to have something to put the fulcrum on too. But he was absolutely right. No matter how little the force you applied, if you have a big enough, and another name for this is mechanical advantage, the ratio of your input distance over your output distance. If that's a big enough ratio, yes, you can move. So let's see the example of that. Let me erase all their Kurt's in the way again. Okay. Let me move you to the other screen, other side of the screen. So let me clear my scribble off of there and let you see what they do. There's our formula. Input force times input distance equal output force to output distance times output distance. When you divide by the output distance, you get exactly what we had, that for the multiplier or mechanical advantage is that distance in divided by distance out, and that gives you the force out that you have. Here is a gal, lady, who is trying to lift 300 pounds. You think she can do it? She looked like she got pretty scrawny arms. She's not a professional weightlifter. Can she lift that 300 pounds?
Yes.
Yes, she can, because her effort is only going to be 60 pounds. That's not too good much. But she's going to push down 2.5 feet. But she's only going to lift this half a foot. And 6 times 2.5, that'd be 150, and half of 300 is 150. Yes, she can lift that 300 pounds because her lever is long enough to give her the mechanical advantage to do that. There's the fulcrum way down here. She can lift 300 pounds. Give her a lever long enough, she could lift a 2,000-pound car. Okay? So the force is multiplied by the product of the distances. Okay? Let me see if I can move this out of the way. By the ratio of the distances. I knew there wasn't enough room there to say product. Ratio of the distances. Now, let's think of some other simple machines besides the lever. That's the fourth one down here. Something very similar to that. Now, I bet y'all have used these before too. An inclined plane, otherwise known as a ramp. Okay? Have you ever tried to lift, say, a motor up onto the back of a pickup truck? Probably not an easy thing to do. But get you an inclined plane there, and maybe some wheels to put it on, and you can roll it up there. Why? Because your distance over which you're moving, the input distance is far longer than the output distance, which is the height of the tailgate. So yeah, an inclined plane is a force multiplier. A wedge, that's not what you did to your younger brother. We're not talking about that. The wedge, any of you ever split firewood? What is an axe or a maul, you know, or a, I can't think what the device is that you use to, you call it a wedge. That's what we always called it. What is that? It's two inclined planes on, you know, put back to back. And your input distance is pretty great. Your output distance is pretty small. I bet you none of you could split, say, a 4-inch oak stump with your fat hands. But given a wedge, yes, you can. Because your input distance would be a great deal more than the amount that you're pushing out. Now think about what a screw is. A screw holds a lot better than a nail, right? One of the reasons for that, a screw is nothing but, picture this, get you an axle that would be like a nail and wrap an inclined plane around it, and you've got a screw. That holds so much better because it's a, you turn and turn and turn on the screw, but it only moves down just a little way into the wood or whatever you're trying to screw up, I mean screw. So there is your screw. Your input distance is a great deal more, so you can hold things together much better. Lever, we've already talked about. A wheel and axle, okay, on your car. Your axle turns, and that's a pretty small diameter, isn't it? But it's turning a great big old wheel here, and you have a big difference in the input and output. Think about a pulley. Now, a pulley that just changes direction, one loop around a wheel at the on the ceiling, you're going to have to, if you're trying to lift 120 pounds, you're going to have to use 120 pounds of force. But if you have that going through the ceiling, coming down through one on the floor, and then going back to the ceiling and coming down, you only have to use 60 pounds to lift that 120 pounds because you're moving 2 feet of rope for every foot that is picked up off the floor, right? Because when you pull here, it's pulling half as much off the floor. Do another loop around the top, and you only have to do a third the amount of work. I know I've asked this several times. Have you ever been to McWane Center? And at the McWane Center, there's that thing that used to be over in the corner, and it was three seats. And one of the seats, you tried to lift yourself with a rope, and that was really hard because it was only one time around the pulley. But the second seat, the medium seat, it was easier to do because it went two times around the pulley at the top. And the third seat was really easy because it went three times around the pulley at the top, you know, three different pulleys. Because every time you do that, you increase the distance that you're pulling, but you're decreasing the force with which you have to pull. Does that make sense? Those are all simple machines. Same principle, force multiplier, that ratio of distances. All right, the next topic, and you have to go back a page then, is power. Now, I'm just guessing that a lot of you use the words force, energy, and power as if they're the same thing. Think about it. I bet you do, don't you? If you had said, what's the difference in these three, would you have been able to give a difference before this course? Force, energy, power?
No.
Yeah, they sound like they mean about the same thing, but they don't. Now, I want to take you back in time a little ways to when we were first talking about displacement. Remember that way back at the very beginning when we talked about displacement. And then we said one thing we're interested in doing is taking the time rate of change of displacement. And we had a name for that. Anyone remember what it's called? Change of distance over change of time. Did someone say something? Distance over time? Speed or velocity, absolutely. And once we got that down, we say, well, what's the time rate of change of velocity? That pedal on the floor. Acceleration, exactly. And then if you remember in the last chapter, we talked about what technically Newton was talking about when he was talking about the fundamental unit of motion, which is mass times velocity, which we now call momentum, time rate of change of momentum, that's exactly what a force is. So we've done time rate of change of just about everything we've run into. Well, now we've run into work. What is the rate at which we do work? The time rate of change of work is power. The rate at which work is done, or the rate at which energy is transformed, that's what power is. Power is work divided by time. Later we'll call it also energy divided by time. Both of those measure power. Now, what are the typical units of work? SI unit of work? Just gave it to me earlier. SI unit of work. Named after? Help me, somebody. Joule. A joule per second is a unit of power. Anyone want to guess what that unit is? Anyone?
A watt?
Okay, yeah, never mind. Okay, now that's a unit. This is a parameter work. This is a unit. You always have to have a number in front of this. 10 watts or something like this. 10 joules in 1 second. That would be what that would represent, okay? These are the units, those are the parameters. So don't get them confused. Capital W stands for work in your formula, but the unit for power is watt, which again is a capital W, okay? U.S. customary, though, we use others. What is our unit for work in U.S. customary? What was that wrench called? Measured in? Work is measured in what in U.S. customary units? Force times distance. Force in U.S. customary. When you stand on the scales. Pounds. And what's your distance? Feet, foot pounds per second. There's your unit of work in the U.S. customary system. Foot pounds per second. However, that's a pretty small unit. So what they do, they take 550 of these foot pounds per second. And guess what they call that? One. You guys, for your cars, you should know this one. The rate at which that car does work is its
horsepower.
You got it. Before we had cars, they were horses, okay? Horse's carriage was a car, right? So, and guess who named it? Came up with that unit? James Watt. And by the way, that cap W is capitalized because it was named after somebody, James Watt. He was a Scottish engineer and physicist, I guess you would say too. And he said the work that an average dray horse, these big old workhorses like your Clydesdales or something, the average work that a big old dray horse could do in a day, work per unit time, work per day, he called that one horsepower. And when he broke it down to foot pounds per second, that came down to about 550 foot pounds per second. So that's where we get the horsepower. Okay? It's units of power, force times distance divided by time. Work divided by time. All right. And you can probably see this, but I can't. So let me move this out of the way over here. Okay. And there's the force of 550 pounds picking up a weight of 550 pounds, 1 foot in 1 second. That's a horsepower. And that's a pretty good amount of power, too. 550 pounds a foot and do that in a second. You got a bit of power. So let me give you another dumb story that goes with power. Remember that rock in the middle of our patio? Big old rock in the middle of our patio. Well, I finally got it loosened, and I finally got it so I could move it and roll it around, but I couldn't lift it and do anything with it. Okay? And about that time, summer was coming to the end. Those last 5 weeks were coming to an end. We had to start back in the fall, and I was working full time in the fall, so I was only going to have weekends to work on the patio. And I'd only gotten about half the patio dug in those 5 weeks. It was hard, dry, hot summer. That clay was so hard, and all those rocks you ran into. So we said, we're going to have to get someone to do the rest of this heavy lifting here. And that we found, and here's why we didn't do it before. We didn't have any room for a bobcat to work until I got about half the patio dug out. Now there was room for a bobcat to go in there and work. So we called around, found this guy. It was Labor Day weekend, I think, maybe the Saturday before Labor Day weekend. And I had worked 5 weeks digging out that soil and, you know, hauling it down. There were other things involved too. But anyway, took me about half the summer, 5 weeks, to get half of the patio done. He came in with that bobcat, a big old bobcat. He dug out the rest of that in about half a day. Okay, now, he didn't haul it down the hill like I was doing, but we'll give him that. He lifted it and put it on the top of the berm at the backyard, okay, from where he was sitting, you know, just piled it up there. But still, he moved about the same amount of soil in half a day that I did in 5 weeks. What was the difference in that picture? We moved the same amount of soil, so let's call it the same work done, but what was the difference? The time. He took a fraction of the time that I did, but why? Because that bobcat had a lot more power than I did. I bet you that bobcat was probably something pretty close to 250 horsepower. I may be exaggerating, but it seemed like that to me. And I'll tell you what, on a hot summer's day, I'm considerably less than half a horsepower. Way less than half a horsepower. So therefore, he could do it in a lot quicker time than I could because he had more power. Does that make sense? All right. Same work was done. The time was different. If you increase the time, you decrease the power. Decrease the time, you increase the power. That's that inverse relationship we talked about before. Okay. Beat that one in the ground, didn't we? So, power is the rate at which work is being done. The units are SI units, watts. Now, you probably don't think of watt as being a mechanical power measure, but it is. You usually think of watts in terms of what kind of power?
Electric.
Electrical power. We'll talk about that in a couple of chapters, okay? We'll get back to that later. But watt also measures mechanical power. In the U.S. customary, we usually use the term horsepower, but foot-pounds per second would work too. But foot-pounds per second is a tiny little unit. Horsepower is a big old unit. Watt is a pretty small unit. What do we usually measure? Not watts, but kilowatts, thousands of watts, okay? So that's what we usually measure it in. Now, here's another example of that. And this was the lab we used to do for this part of the chapter. Walking versus running upstairs. So what we would be doing probably Thursday in class or in lab after class was over with, I would give you a worksheet and take you to different stairwells, and everybody would both walk up the stairs, and then you'd measure how high the stairs were. You'd walk up the stairs measuring how long it took you. Then you'd run at a very reasonable pace, not to make any injuries or anything, up the stairs, someone time you there, and you talk about the difference in work. There was no difference in work. Same work done walking up the stairs as running up the stairs. The difference is the time. The time running is much less, so you have that takes more power to run up the stairs than it does to walk. Now, let's get back to your electrical. What comes in every month that either you or your parents have to pay? The power bill. Is that really measuring power? No, you're paying for energy. You're not paying for power. Believe it or not, you're not. They call it the power bill because it comes from the Alabama Power Company, okay? But it's not a power bill. If you look at the bill, get your folks to show you one, or if you pay it yourself, look at it and see what units it's measured in. It's measured in kilowatt hours, not kilowatts. Kilowatts would be power. Kilowatt hours, if you think about it, power is work divided by time. If you multiply both sides by time, this would be kilowatt times hours. Now, that's not our usual unit, and that would be the work or the energy that you're using. You're paying for energy, kilowatt hours, you're not paying power. Okay? Let me erase my scratch here, and we'll see what they have to say about it. Oh, here's a poor old guy that looks like me, doesn't he? Trying to climb up those stairs. Takes him a long time. He does the same amount of work this guy down here does, but it's taking him a long time to do it. He's expending the same energy, but because he's going so slowly, that's a large time, low power. However, this guy, who's in a big hurry here, going up the same flight of stairs, doing the same work, his weight, they have to weigh the same, okay, up the same distance, that's the same. So guess what? The only difference is the time it took him to get there. And if he's going fast, that time is small, his power output is much greater. Okay? Does that make sense? Okay. Are we ready? There is a little, it's not exactly an example, but it's something we can do. This is on the right-hand column of page 65. Consider the work and time factors. A 120-pound person. What's that a measure of? 120-pound person. That's not mass. That is weight, which weight is a type of?
Force.
That's a force, okay? Okay? He's ran up a 10-foot flight of stairs. 10 feet is a what? Is that a measure of?
Distance.
Okay. And he did it in 4 seconds. Boy, that sounds like Jacob's car. You know, never mind. The time it took him was 4 seconds. Okay. What was his power output? What's the formula for power? Work per unit time or energy per unit time. And what's work?
120 pounds.
Okay, no, that's force. Work is force times the displacement over time. Okay, that's work is force times displacement. Power is that over time. So this would be your 120 pounds times your distance of 10 feet divided by 4 seconds. Now, I'm lazy, so I'm going to cancel what I can. 4 going to 120 30 times, and 30 times 10 is 300 what units? 1 unit could be foot pounds per second, right? And what's a foot pound per second? Anybody? A what? A watt. Right, okay, we got it. So that would be 300 watts. No, it isn't. That's Newton. That's not watts. Okay. Foot pounds per second. You almost threw me there. Okay. We'll leave it like that. That's what it is. Unless, of course, you want to figure out how many horsepower that is. Well, let's do that. We've got 300 foot-pounds per second. We're going to multiply that by blank-blank to give us blank horsepower. Now, like I said before, you always put the units in their place. The first blank is for numbers, the second blank for units. What unit do you put where? Foot-pounds per second, either top or bottom. Horsepower, either bottom or top. You decide. Help me, somebody. Anybody?
Can you ask a question again,
Mr. Power? Okay, we're trying to go from foot-pounds per second to horsepower. Okay? When you're trying to make a unit conversion like that, get you two blanks there, one for numbers, one for units, and you're trying to find out how many horsepower. So, always put the units in their place. What unit goes on top, which is on bottom? Horsepower or foot-pounds per second? Which goes where?
Horsepower goes at the bottom.
Okay, if horsepower is on the bottom here, is that what you said?
Yes.
Okay, and then foot-pounds per second would go up here, and that would give you foot-pounds per second squared over horsepower. That's not giving you horsepower. So it looks like they got to go the other way. If you put the horsepower on top and foot-pounds per second on bottom, then the foot-pounds per second are going to cancel out, aren't they? Now, do you remember how many horsepower in a foot-pound per second, or how many foot-pounds per second in a horsepower? Which way? 550 what? Oh, yeah, 550 foot-pounds per second is one horsepower, exactly. So what that means, you take your 300 and divide it by 550, which is 30 divided by 55, which is 6 divided by 11. I don't know what that is. Someone punch that in on your calculator. Say again. 0.59, is that what you said? 545? I don't hear well. Is that what you said?
Yeah, about a half horsepower.
Yeah, about a little over half a horsepower. Exactly. So that guy thought he was running pretty fast, but boy, 4 seconds is not that fast. Okay, just over half a horsepower. All right, they have a little concept supplied on the bottom of page 65. It looks like it's a little lame, but you can take a look at it if you want to. It shows on page 67 underneath the... Oh, and I didn't mention this when we did the simple machines. If you look at the, on page 67, that box there, if you have your effort, that's the force you put into it, and you have a fulcrum somewhere in between, your resistance on the other end, they call that a first-class lever. That would be like the woman, your jack picking up the car. Okay, that would be a first class lever. However, you could put the fulcrum at the end, put your resistance somewhere in between, and put your effort at the other end. What does that look like? It is a simple machine. Anyone got an idea? Any other? Say again?
A pulley?
No, that's not a pulley. You see at the top of page 67. Top of the page, not the bottom.
Okay.
That, okay? It's called a second-class lever. The fulcrum's on one end, the resistance is in the middle kind, and the effort's on the other end. What does that look like?
Seesaw.
A seesaw is that first one, the first-class lever. Mm-hmm. This is one. Any of you ever done any masonry work? Actually, I used it when I was digging out the yard. When I was moving the soil from up the hill to down the hill, I filled up my
wheelbarrow.
That's it, exactly. The wheel is your fulcrum. Your load is in between, and you're at the handles on the end. And you can carry a lot more soil in a wheelbarrow than you can carry in a bucket. Okay? That's because you have a second-class lever. Now, your third-class lever, that's a little different. Your fulcrum's at one end, your effort is in the middle, and your resistance is way at the other end. Now, I used that too when I was digging out the patio. What does that look like? Your resistance is at the far end, your effort about midway, and your fulcrum is at the one end. What do I use to dig with?
A shovel.
A shovel, exactly. My right hand would be the fulcrum. My effort hand would be about midway down the shovel. I'd pick up that scoop of soil and move it. I wasn't interested in moving a lot of weight of soil. I wanted to move it a distance, and that enabled me to do that. My mechanical advantage was half there. It wasn't very great. I wasn't picking up lots of soil, but I was moving at a bigger distance. That's a third-class lever, by the way. Now, the bottom of that page, I think what Kyle was looking at, the guy pulling with a force of about 1 newton, which is only about a little over a fifth of a pound, not very much force, so he's not struggling at all, lifting a 1 newton, a fifth of a pound, 1 meter, it only takes him a second. Yeah, that's 1 foot-pound per second, which is a what unit? Foot-pound per second. I'm sorry, not foot-pound, newton-meter per second. What's a newton-meter per second?
A watt?
Yeah, okay, a watt, right, okay. He's doing 1 watt. See, a watt is a very, very small amount of power. All right, that gets us ready for example 3.3. This is on the top first column of page 68. Okay. An electric lift, thank you, I don't have to lift this anymore, can raise 500 kilogram, and they tell you what it is, that's the mass. The mass is 500.0, that's quite a precise mass, kilogram. A distance of 10 meters. So your distance here is 10.0 meters. In, the time is 5.0 seconds. Okay? What is the power of that lift? What is the formula for power?
Work over time.
Okay, work divided by time. Okay, that's capital W for work, not for watts, over time. What is work? Say again? Okay, yeah, but we could do that, but in basic units, the first definition we have for work at the first of the chapter. Force times displacement. Perfect. We're dealing with metric units now, so don't use feet, they're meters. Force times displacement over time, okay? That work is force times displacement. Do we have force anywhere in this picture? No, we have mass. So what is your force if you know the mass? Force is Newton's second law, almost. It wasn't that long ago, was it? Huh? What force are we talking about if you're lifting something? Okay, it's the mass times the acceleration due to gravity. That's weight, by the way. That's your force we're dealing with, times your distance divided by time. Okay, now we can go to town with this. Your mass is 500 kilograms. Okay, your acceleration due to gravity was what? 9.8 meters per second squared times your distance was 10 meters, and the time was 5 seconds. Okay, and that was 10.0 meters. Okay, I forgot my picture. Okay, now I'm going to do this a little bit the easier way, and that's going to do 5 into 500 will be 100. Okay, and 100 times 10 is 1,000, and 1,000 times 9.8 would be 9,800, and the units would be kilogram meter per second squared. That's a newton meter per second. What's a newton meter per second? A newton meter is a joule per second, and what's a joule per second? A what? A watt. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So this is your watt, capital W watt. Now, 9,800.
9.8 kilowatts.
Ah, very good. You beat me to it. 9.8 kilowatts. Okay. What did the book have? I lost it. Okay. They did 9.8. Yeah, they get 9.8 watts. Now, what if you wanted to determine what that was in horsepower? Okay. That's a completely different unit. I'll refer you back, turn back a page or two to page 66. I think is where this is. I'm having to use a light because it's so overcast outside. Here we have it. Here's some more conversions you might need to know. 746 watts is 1 horsepower. 746 watts is a horsepower. Now that tells you a few things. Number one, a watt is a very small unit of power. Horsepower is a pretty big unit of horsepower. But if you move that 3 decimal places, this would be 0.746 kilowatts is 1 horsepower. So a kilowatt and a horse, a kilopower, no, it's a horsepower. Okay. A kilowatt and a horsepower are very close to one another. About 3/4 of a kilowatt is 1 horsepower. Okay? So, if we went back to our 9,800 watts, and you wanted to convert this to horsepower, what do you do first? There's 2 blanks there. 1 blank, the first blank is for numbers, second blank for units. What do you put in place first? Always put the units. Say again, horsepower goes where?
On the top.
A horsepower on top, that puts watts on the bottom. Now, what? How do you relate those two together? Now you put the numbers in the place.
That would be 1.
1 horsepower is
746
watts. So you take that 9,800 watts divided by 746. You always do things in the numerator divided by things in the denominator. By the way, the watts are going to cancel out. And do 9,800 divided by 746. Someone with a calculator. A little louder. Did I hear something about 13?
Yes.
Okay. That's what the book had, so I was trusting them to do it right. About 13 horsepower. Okay. Now, I think what they were doing was considering this is 4 significant digits. That's 3, that's 2. So our answer can't be more than 2 significant digits. Well, it came out being 9,800. That means only these two digits are significant. So therefore, only these two are. And even though you have 3 digits here, that doesn't matter. You can only have 2 digits in your answer, 13. Okay? I know the decimal didn't come out exactly 13. But that's where they got it. Any questions on that? Got it? Do you need this up a little longer? Take your time.
That was it.
Everybody? You are? Okay. All right, we'll erase this then and go to 3.4. A 150-pound person, what's that a measure of? That's weight or force. I'm going to use force because I don't want to confuse the little w of weight with the capital W, okay, of work. Runs up a 15-foot stairway. What's 15 feet a measure of?
Distance.
Now, when they say that, I think they mean running up 15 feet. It's probably running a lot further than that. Okay. What is the horsepower? So we're looking for power. That's the unknown here. Rating. Oh, I forgot something. A 15-foot stairway in 10.0 seconds. What's that a measure of?
Time.
Okay. So we're looking for power. Okay. What's the horsepower rating of that person? Boy, he's probably worse off than the last one was, because the last one was 120 pounds, I think, running up a 10-foot stairs, and it only took him 4 seconds. So I think this is a lazy bones. Never mind. Okay. Anyway, what is power? What's the formula for it?
Work over time.
Work divided by time. And what's work?
Force time displacement.
Force times displacement divided by time. And what's the force? Oh, we already got it all, don't we? Let's plug in then. Okay, so this will be your force is 150 pounds. Your displacement is 15 feet. And the time it took was 10 seconds. Okay. Well, if you multiply those together, I think you get 2250, I believe, divided by 10, which is, I believe that's right. Check my work here. That's 225 foot pounds per second. But we wanted to know what is the horsepower rating of that person. So we're trying to get horsepower out of 225. Someone check my work. I hope I'm right there. Foot pounds per second. Times blank blank, and that's equal to blank horsepower. What do we put where?
Horsepower
on top, and foot pounds per second on the bottom. Those are going to cancel out then. Now I need to match numbers with the units. How many horsepower in a foot-pound per second, or how many feet-pound per second in a horsepower? It wasn't that long ago.
It's 1/5 feet.
1 horsepower is 550 foot-pounds per second. So take your 225 divided by 550. Now, I don't have a calculator handy. I've got one, but it's not handy. I could divide out 25s at a time. What do you get, huh? 0.41 horsepower. And that's what the book got. Someone was reading the book, weren't they? No, I'm just kidding. Okay. Good. I'm glad you're reading your book anyway. All right. So that is your horsepower, 0.41. A little bit less than half a horsepower. The other guy, remember, he was a little bit more than half a horsepower. Now, any questions on any of that? Whew, believe it or not, that only finishes 3.1, okay? So let's move on to 3.2, which is talking about motion, position, and energy. Now, this is being covered by stuff, so I'm going to move this down here. Try to get it out of the way. Motion, position, and energy. Closely related to the concept of work is the concept of energy. Now, catch this connection here. Energy is defined to be the ability to do work. Okay? That's how energy is defined. And I thought here they also gave the reverse, and they don't. thought they did. I think in the old book. I'm going to try something. You tell me if this makes things better or worse. I'm going to turn off that light and turn on this one. The glare off the page is pretty bad. Is that? Y'all probably think that's a lot better because you don't see me as well, right? But you can still see the screen okay, can't you?
Yes.
Okay. So let's go with that. Okay. Yeah, they don't give the reverse definition. I think it's work is the result of using energy, basically is how I would say it. It's probably not the best way, but work is the result of using energy. Okay. Energy, the ability to do work. Work is a result of using energy. What is this all getting to? They are measured exactly the same way. The unit for energy is joule. The unit for work is joule. They're measured exactly the same. In fact, there will be an awful lot of similarities, as you'll see. So let's just say that we had a book on the floor next to a bookcase. Remember that picture back there? But this time it's on the floor. Let's see. I'm going to, well, now I can't do that because I've moved that in the way. Let me see if I can move these. Okay. All right. Work and energy, as we were saying, are related to one another. Energy is the ability to do work. I didn't know it was on here. And work is the process of changing an energy level. I knew that definition was somewhere here. It's on the slide. Work is the process of changing energy levels. Okay? The result of doing work, of using energy. Process of changing energy level. Okay. What's coming up in this section, we'll be talking about the relationship between the work and energy associated with position. And when we say position, we mostly mean position up or down in a gravitational field. That kind of position. Sideways is not doing any work. It's only the up and down that is doing work. So relation of energy associated with position. Later we'll talk about the energy of moving charges when we're talking electricity, of moving, you know, magnetic material if you're dealing with magnetism. So we can talk about other things too. Heat is energy levels that way. So we will talk about others. Now we're talking about energy associated with position. Then coming up with that is relationship within between work and the energy of motion. And we're going to get to the definition of this energy associated with position and that associated with motion. That's what's coming next. So first, potential energy. Okay? That's the energy associated with position. Okay? Now there's all sorts of different kinds of potential energies. This one is gravitational potential energy. So what you measure is the h, the height. Okay? And in order to measure the height, you need to have a reference height. Now this is also sometimes called a zero position level, okay? What are you measuring from? It doesn't matter. Right now, my book here is sitting on the desk where I'm working, okay? If you call this work, okay? If I lift the book off the table, the desktop, then it has potential energy relative to the desktop. How far I lifted it there. That's the energy above the desktop. But if I move back a little bit and hold it off the floor, now its zero reference level is the floor. Over here, it was a table. If I would go over to the window there and hold it out the window, it would be the ground, right? That, I'm on the second floor, so that would be a greater potential energy. if you went above sea level, that would even be greater, okay? You have to determine your reference level, the zero reference level. Here's my working definition of that. As low as this book could go in its given problem. If the only distance I'm dropping it is onto the desktop, use the desktop as a zero reference level. If there's a potential I could drop it onto the floor, use the floor as a potential, as a reference level. If I'm going to hold it out the window, use the ground or whatever, okay? You determine what the zero reference level is for your particular problem, as low as the book can go or the object can go. The next lab we would have been doing if we were on campus, we would go back and have a pendulum, and you would be measuring the weight off the floor at the lowest point it could go. That would be your reference height. And then you'd be lifting it a meter off the floor and determining how much, and you would do a lot of calculations with that. I'll have to find something in the virtual lab to see what we can do with that, okay? So anyway, that's your gravitational potential energy. You need to know your reference level so you can measure the height from there. There are other ways of measuring of potential energy rather than gravitational potential energy. There's also elastic or spring potential energy. Now, if you think about a spring, do some of your vehicles still have coil springs, or are they all leaf springs now? I think they still have coil springs, don't we? Okay. And those are pretty stiff springs, wouldn't you say? If you were to stretch those, you're going to have to do a lot of force to get them to stretch. Similarly, to get them to compress, you'd have to put a lot of pressure on them. Okay. How much you're compressing or stretching that spring, that is its displacement. Okay. Later in a couple chapters, we'll talk about electric charges and their potential energy. Now, I mentioned that before. That would be electrical potential energy. We often call that voltage. It's not exactly the same, but it's awfully close to it. Okay? Now, work can change the potential energy of an object. Remember I said I took the book and I lifted it off the desktop? Guess what? I did work on the book to get it from the desktop to up there. That was MGH, remember? Well, no, we haven't gotten there yet, okay. But that was what the work done was, the height times the force times the displacement, okay? So work can change your potential energy. Kinetic energy can change into potential energy and vice versa. That would have been the lab we did next Tuesday, okay? But we're not there, we're not gonna do them. Okay, so here we have a book. Some dummy dropped it off the top of a building, okay? That we consider a positive potential energy. Now, if it was in the room on the fourth floor there, and he just lifted it off the floor, then that would be his reference height. The floor would be zero reference level. That would be the height he had it lifted. That would be his potential energy. But if then he went and hung it out the window and dropped it, then it's going all the way to the ground. Well, if he's still using the floor of that room on the fourth floor to be his reference height, now you've got a negative potential energy because your height is now below the zero reference level. So that's why it's important to choose that. It's okay to have a negative potential energy. Just realize that that's what you're dealing with. If you moved your reference level down to the ground, then it would make more sense, to me anyway. Okay, so wherever you choose your reference level to be, that's your zero height, that's your zero potential energy level. Anything above that would be a positive potential energy. Anything below that would be negative. Why negative? Because in order to get it back to the fourth floor, you're going to have to lift it and do work on it to get it to go back to zero. Okay, does that sort of make sense? Wow, one slide or two slides is all they had on potential energy. So let's do a couple of examples with that. Oh, they didn't even give the formula. Oh, there it is. There's the formula for it. I thought I was. Oh, here's the. This is the better formula for it. Okay. Potential energy. And when I say this, I like to say GPE. Gravitational potential energy is MGH. Now, if you think that looks like a lot like work, it is a lot like work. Because MG is your force, H is your distance. That's almost the same formula. That's why they have the same units. So gravitational potential energy is very, very closely related to work. Okay? So, with that in mind, let's do, example 3.5. So let me see if I can get to that here. So let me clear my screen. We'll do example 3.5. What is the potential energy of a 2.14 kilogram book? Wow, what's that a measure of? 2.14 kilograms. What's that measuring? Say again? Mass, absolutely. Okay. That is on a bookshelf 1 meter above the floor. What's that a measure of?
Distance
on, only when we're talking about gravitational potential energy, the book uses height. Same difference, height or distance, they mean the same, okay? Above the floor. So what is the potential energy? What is potential energy? I like to call it GPE. I just had it on the screen. What was that? Help me somebody.
MGH.
Perfect. And what's your mass?
2.14
kilograms. Always use a unit with it. What's your G? Help me. G? 9.8 what? Meters per second squared. That's an acceleration. Great unit for that. What's your height? 1.0 meters. Okay. Now I'm going to need a calculator for that one. 2.14 times 9.8. It's going to be something about 2.0 something. No, 20 point something. In fact, pretty close to 20, isn't it? 20 or 21? Say again?
20.97.
One more time.
20.97.
Okay. 1-1? Okay. Okay.
21.
Okay, oh yeah. Okay, I see what you say. Yeah, that rounds to 21. What unit? The ladies like them? Joules, exactly. A kilogram, meter squared per second squared, that's a joule. Right? And the book got it right. Good for them. Okay? Everybody got that one?
Yes.
Ready for the next? Can I erase?
Yes.
Okay. I'm sorry. Excuse me. Let me get something to drink. Kill this cough. Example 3.6, top of page 69, right column. How much work? So now we're looking for work. This is the unknown here. Can a 5 kilogram mass, 5.00 kilogram, what's that a measure of? Oh, they just told us. Mass. Do if it is 5 meters above the ground. 5.00 meters above the ground. What's that?
Height.
That's your height, H. Okay? Now, how much work can that do? Seems like we're back to a work problem, doesn't it? Okay? What's the definition of work, which is also change of potential energy? What is that? Help me, somebody. Work.
Is that P times T?
Say that again.
Is that P times T?
I couldn't quite hear. What did you say again?
She said power times time.
Okay, if we had power, that would work. But we don't have power. There's no power listed in this problem. But that is a definition for work. You're absolutely right. But in terms, we don't really have everything we need. We have mass and height. So what would be the formula closest to that? Work is? Oh boy, it wasn't that long ago, was it?
Force times
the distance. Okay, now we don't have force. We do have a distance. Now your height. Okay. Now, how is force related to mass? What force are you talking about if you're having a mass above the ground? Anybody? Say again. When you stand on the scales. What are you measuring?
Weight.
Weight is a force. And what is weight? The force due to weight. It's a chapter ago. Don't use it over and over and over again. What's force due to weight? What are you working against when you're lifting something?
Gravity.
So what's that force? Has G in it, that's a hint.
Is it MG?
MG times your H. There it is. And what's your mass? Help me. There it is. 5.00 kilograms times what's your G?
9.8.
What units? Meter per second squared. And what's your height?
5.00
meters, right?
Uh-huh, yeah.
Multiply those together. Someone got a calculator? A little louder? 250, is that what I heard?
Yes.
That's what it rounds to, 250 joules. Kilogram, meter squared per second squared is a joule. The reason they only have two significant digits here, even though this has three and that has three, the 9.8 only has two. So that's how they rounded. I think it came out 249 or something like that, didn't it?
Yes.
Okay, but you rounded it up to 250 because there's only two significant digits in 9.8. All right. There's a little concept applied there in work and power, and that's basically the same thing we were talking about going up and down the stairs, or going up the stairs. That would have been the lab we did on Thursday. We're not going to be there, so we can't do it. All right, moving on to page 69, the bottom of that page, and that's where we went to before, but I was a bit premature. Is kinetic energy. Now, what does the term kinetic mean to you? Anything?
Movement.
Moving, exactly. There's a whole field of study called kinesiology. That's the study of motion. I have a nephew who is now a physical therapist, but that was his undergraduate major because he was planning to go into physical therapy, he did his major in kinesiology, the study of movement and motion. So that's what kinetic is. So this is the energy of motion, not the energy of position. That's just how high something is above something, or how much something has compressed something or expanded something. That's position. This is the energy associated with motion. This results from the work or change in potential energy. I'll give you some examples of that. If I were to lift this book above the desk, like I've done several times now, this is how I'm getting my exercise today, okay? If I lifted it at a gradual speed, I've done work on it and given it potential energy above the desk. Now, if I were to release that book right there, I don't want to damage the desk, so I'm not going to do it, but if I were to release the book from up here, what would be its initial velocity? I'm holding it here. It's not moving. What's its initial velocity?
Rest.
It's at rest. And what's its initial velocity? Zero. Because it's not moving. But then if I released it, it's going to start moving and start moving pretty quickly as it falls. And as it falls, it's going to pick up more and more speed. So guess what? That's the energy associated with motion. So the book picks up kinetic energy as it loses its potential energy. It results from work, either lifting it or change of potential energy. Now, any of you, pick your favorite sport. What is it? A favorite sport. Anyone?
Football.
Football. Okay. Let's start with that quarterback. And if it's third and long, there's a good chance, what's he going to call as his next play? Unless he has a mighty good running back, he's probably going to
throw it.
Okay? So what he's doing with that football, he's rearing back and changing the potential energy of his arm into movement of the football. Right? He's giving that football kinetic energy. It results from doing work. He's doing work on the football, changing the potential energy of that football. Now, as it goes up into an arc, and by the way, all of them go into an arc, as it goes up into the arc, it's losing some of that kinetic energy because it's slowing down because gravity's pulling it downward. But then when it reaches the peak, it still has a component of horizontal energy, moving horizontally, but now it starts coming down toward his receiver. Hopefully he'll catch it in stride and make it to the end zone, or at least the first down. Okay? That's change of potential energy. That is kinetic energy, the energy of motion. Here is the formula. I'm surprised they haven't given it to you. Oh, there it is. Here is the formula. Kinetic energy is 1/2 mass times velocity squared. Okay? I think I told you early on, most of the time when your variable is squared, you're going to have a 2 in the coefficient in the denominator of the coefficient. Most of the time that's going to be the case. One time it was the centripetal force or acceleration was velocity squared over radius, and that didn't have a 1/2 in front, even though velocity was squared. But this is, most of them have that. Remember our displacement formula before? Displacement was 1/2 the acceleration times the time squared. Well, this is kinetic energy, 1/2 the mass times the velocity squared. A lot of times when you have squared it as your variable, you're going to have a 1/2 in front, or something over 2. All right, let's check and see if our units make sense. I'm not sure they do. What's the unit for mass in the SI unit? Anybody? Help me. Mass in the SI unit. Only mass we really use very much.
Kilograms.
Kilogram. Now how about velocity? What's velocity in the SI unit? Okay, I'll give it to you in U.S. customary. One would be miles per hour, distance over time. What would it be in the SI units?
Kilometers an hour.
Say again?
Kilometers an hour.
Okay, you could use that one, but we're doing something much smaller
meters
than that.
Meters per second.
Excellent. But that velocity is squared. So that's going to be kilograms. That's not squared. Meter squared per second squared. What's that a measure of? Kilogram meter squared per second squared. Just gave it to me earlier. Ladies like them.
Joules.
Yes, there you have them. Kilogram meter squared per second squared is a joule. Now, what are some ramifications of this? Here's one. When you double your speed, what do you do your kinetic energy? Quadruple it. Okay? Because if you double the speed, kinetic energy goes up by 4 times. Okay? What's some ramifications of that? Okay, out there on the highway, if you're going along, tooling along because you're in slow traffic or something, at 30 miles per hour, you're probably not a happy camper. But if someone stops in front of you, let's just say it takes you a certain distance to stop. Okay? But now increase that speed to 60 miles per hour. Are you going to double your distance to stop? No, you quadruple the distance to stop. So if you're going along at 60 miles per hour compared to 30, if you're traveling a safe distance behind that car in front of you at 30 miles per hour, multiply that by 4, that's going to be your safe distance behind that same vehicle at 60 miles per hour. That's hard to imagine, but it's true. And I know when I lived out in California when I was in the Navy, you would hear about these wrecks. And they just didn't have little wrecks out there. They had massive wrecks. Mostly what caused it was in the morning time out there, you'd have that wind blowing in off the Pacific Ocean just all night long at a cool temperature. Okay? And toward morning, the temperature kept dropping, and soon that produced a fog. Well, then people would be on the highway racing into work in San Francisco, say from Sacramento or somewhere else like that, and they would hit those fog banks. They couldn't see the car in front of them until they got close enough to see those little red lights, and by then they slammed on the brakes, not enough time to stop. And guess what? The person behind them, not enough time to stop. The person behind, they had massive chain reaction accidents. They would talk about them. This is a 7-car collision. This is a 15-car collision. It was amazing. The insurance companies must have been eating that up or getting eaten up one. It was awful. Okay. And that's why you double your speed, quadruple your distance. Okay. That's one practical ramification of that. Okay. Wow. That's the only slide they have on kinetic energy. So let us, and I wish they showed the one that's in the book, the guy with the bowling ball. Okay, any of you ever bowled? I'm not very, yeah, okay. You know what you do first? You pick up that ball behind you. You're lifting it off the floor. You're changing its potential energy. By lifting it, you're doing work on the ball, lifting it, and then you both let it drop and also throw it too. So by both of those motions, letting it drop increases its kinetic energy, but also any force you put behind it increases its kinetic energy because you're adding work to it, and then it rolls down the bowling lane, and hopefully mine usually wind up in the gutter, but let's ignore that. If it stays in the lane, then it's going to be those are pretty level lanes, right? So it's going to be at a constant kinetic energy then because There's no more change of potential or force being added to it, so it's a constant speed, constant kinetic energy, until it hits the bowling pins. And mine sometimes wouldn't, but hopefully it does. And then it changes all that kinetic energy it had and gives it to those various pins, and still the ball hits the back with a pretty large force. You hear it whomp against the back. That's when it changes its kinetic energy. Okay? I don't know how to spell whomp. But anyway, that's kinetic energy measured in joules, by the way, as we just showed here. Let's do example 3.7 on the right-hand column of page 70. Now, how are we doing on time, by the way? We've been in at about 2 hours, but we got a late start. How are we doing? 3:38. So we stop me at 3:45, okay?
Okay.
All right. So, I just realized something I didn't do, but I think we can get example 3.7 in here. Okay? Let me... Wait a minute. I hit the wrong key. Okay. There. That's what I want to hit. Okay. 3.7. Oh, they heard what we were talking about. A 7.00 kilogram bowling ball. What's that a measure of? Somebody. Mass. Perfect. Okay. Is moving in a bowling lane, hopefully not in the gutter, with a velocity of 5.00 meters per second. They just told you that was its velocity. What is the kinetic energy of the bowling ball? What is KE? What's that formula?
1/2.
M?
V to the square.
V squared. Perfect. So that'd be 1/2. And what's the mass?
7.00
kilograms times, what's the velocity? 5.00 meters per second, but we're squaring that, okay? That'd be 1/2 of 7.00 kilograms. Now, square first. 5 squared is? Help me, somebody.
25.
25. I'll put a .0 there. It doesn't matter. You also square the units. Meter squared per second squared. Okay? Now, maybe time to pull out a calculator, because I won't do this on my head. You can say 1/2 of 7 is 3.5 times 25. That's somewhere close to 80 or so, isn't it? Help me, somebody. Between 80 and 90?
Yes.
What'd you get?
87.5.
87.5. What unit?
Joule.
Joules. Kilogram, meter squared per second squared is a joule. Perfect. And that's what they got in the book, too. So we got time for 3.8. Does anyone need this a little longer?
Just a moment.
Okay. Take your time.
Okay.
All right. Everybody got it? Do we have time for 3.8? Okay, we got 4 minutes. Let's see if we can do it. A hundred kilogram football player, that's pretty big. 100.0 kilogram. Anyone know what that measures?
Mass.
Mass. Is moving with a velocity of 6.0 meters per second. They told us that was the velocity. He tackles a poor old stationary quarterback That means that quarterback wasn't moving ahead of time. How much work did he do on that quarterback? So he went from a kinetic energy that's represented by this to a kinetic energy of zero. That's going to be how much work he did on it. So let's figure out what the kinetic energy was here. Ke initially was what? What's the formula?
Half.
1/2.
Mass.
Mass, which is 100.0 kilograms times which is 6.0 squared, which is 36 meters squared per second squared. Okay, we're running out of time, so I'm sort of doing it fast. Sorry. Well, half of 36 is 18, right? And 18 times 100 is 1800. And what would be the units? Joules. 1,800 joules of work he did on that quarterback. That means that quarterback's going to be pretty bruised the next morning, don't you think? Because 100 kilogram, that sounds like a linebacker to me. That would be about 220 pounds. That's about right. Moving at 6 meters per second is pretty fast. He's doing some work on that quarterback. Okay? Now, if you wanted a smaller number but bigger unit, what would that be? Somebody had it before when we're dealing with watts. Let's do the same thing with joules. That comma represents 1,000. What metric prefix stands for 1,000? Kilo. That's 1.8 kilojoules. Okay, sort of an unusual thing, but you could use it. They, in the book, use 1,800 joules. Okay, 1.8 kilojoules. Make sense? Yay or nay? Okay, yay! All right, good. We'll start next time with energy flow, 3.3. Okay? So that's where I'll end this time. This is time for class to end, right?
Yes.
Okay. I didn't want to cheat you out of any of your tuition dollars here. Unless, if you have your labs, get them out. And I will end the PowerPoints here. And I'm going to have to move Jeff again. Move you down here this time. You probably can't see me do that, but I did. So I want to get rid of this. Whoops. Then that, I know you lost your screen, but that's because we're going to, I've got to open my other thing. And so let me minimize this for a moment here. I hit the wrong key. I want to minimize. I hit the expansion key. Minimize this for a moment. And let me get into Blackboard. I had to think where it was. It's in Blackboard. Sorry, I should have had this set up before, but I was so rushed in between my last class and this class, I didn't have time. And then my computer screwed up. So we're a minute into lab time. Now, I guess you know, you probably have gotten up and taken breaks whenever you wanted to. It's going to be a few minutes, so if you have been sitting very still and you want to get up and move some, it's going to take me a little while to get this loaded, it looks like. It's not going to be that long, but it's moving awfully slowly now. And nothing's happened so far, so I'm going to hit it again. It'll probably do it twice then. Ah, there it comes. Okay, so let me go to, I have to wait until Blackboard shows up. The one up there doesn't work, this one does. Okay. The computer is awfully slow right now. Sorry. taking forever to open anything. So if you have your lab, you can follow me, because I'm going to Blackboard right now. And I have to log in, and this is a slow process too, for us anyway. Well, there we go. Okay, do y'all have to go through all this to get in your Blackboard?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. The old one was much easier than this, much quicker. Now, do you have to wait for this next screen to come up?
We can't see your screen.
Oh, you can't. That's right. I'll get that back up in a few minutes. You're only looking at me sitting here, dead to the world. And then I have to log in again to Microsoft. I guess this is on the web or on the cloud or somewhere, I guess we're doing. Okay, here we have it. Okay. It's taking a few minutes. I'm fairly impatient. I'm just about in Blackboard. Okay. I wonder if I put this on the screen if it would follow it. Oh, it probably would. Let me try that. Okay, here we go. Let me... Okay, why am I not able to get that to come back up? Okay. See if I can figure this out. Return to meeting, that might work. Ah, there we go. Let's see if sharing screen will work now. That is the one I want, I think. Okay, you can see my Blackboard page now?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Sorry, that took longer than I wanted it to. Okay, I have to scroll down here, but I can't find my scroll. Let me try it this way. Ah, sorry, I'm on the activity screen. No, that was right. Yeah, there, that's where I need to be. Okay. There we go, that's us. Y'all can see this, right?
Yes.
Okay. All right, now we're in Blackboard for this course, okay? Now, I don't know if your screen looks like this. It probably doesn't. So I'm going to scroll down until I reach the laboratory simulations. Now, I did put one more up here recently, and let me show that to you now, too. The library link. I don't know if anyone saw that. This may be useful if you're working on your research paper, hint, hint. And by the way, I have gotten several in. This class is probably leading all my others, and you're a second mini-term. I've gotten 4 papers in from you. Way to go, people. Okay. But anyway, let's go to the laboratory simulations. Are you following this? Okay.
Yes.
And Jeff, is this what you tried to do? Is Jeff still here? I see your name up there.
Yeah.
Okay. And you clicked on this?
Yes.
Okay. And did you get the screen that's coming up now? It takes a while.
Yes.
It says low system resources may affect their audio quality. Try closing some applications. I can't. Okay. Okay. But anyway, you go here to simulations. Does everybody see that?
Yes.
Okay. Go down to physics. This is on the lab. If you're following in lab, I've gone to the Blackboard page for the course. We've gone to course content. That's however it does on yours. Scroll down to, pick the course, okay? And I may have that course content out of the way. That's how I got here. And then click on simulations and then click on physics, okay? So I'm going to click there. And there you see all these, okay? These are pretty much alphabetical. What you're going down to is forces in motion, basics. So scroll down through the B's, through the C's, through the D's, through the E's, and here we're getting into the forces. Now, I tried this force in motion. I couldn't make much of a lab out of that one, but this is the one we're going to work with today. Forces in motion, basics. Does everybody see that? Click on that. And then it comes up. Now, I still got this screen here that says low system resource. I'm going to get this out of the way, I think. Yes. Okay, it's gone. All right. Now it says download. Okay. Everybody following this? So I'm going to click on download. And it sometimes takes a while. This one doesn't take as long as some of them do. But you have to wait until it finishes its download. And then on my computer, it's down here in the corner. When it says 2.7 out of 2.7 or whatever it is, then you can click on that and see what happens. If nothing happens, oh, there it comes. If nothing happens, you can go to the arrow and tell it to open. That's why I put open there. Okay. And you're getting this interactive motion. Now, we're just going to do the net force one. We're not doing the other two. I thought we might do a couple of those. I filled up the page with this one, so I quit. So we're going to this one, okay? Does everybody see how we got there? Okay, now I'm going to have to move people around here. This is out of the way now. Then you click on sum of forces, values, and speed. And you see when you sum of forces came up, you see sum of forces equals zero. You don't see any values yet because you don't have any. Okay, but speed, you now got a dial here. That's what you're going to look at for speed. Now, you don't know what units these are. Nothing that are given in units. Don't worry about that. But just tell what's happening to the speed. Okay, now I say next, drag a little blue android. You see this one? Drag him up to the knot, and as soon as you see that circle, you can let him go, and he pops up there. Now it says, record the sum of forces. What is it? 50 newtons. In which direction? Left. Okay. There's your first two questions. Jeff, are you getting these?
Yeah, I can get into this one, but I can't get into the other ones. I don't know if it's because it's through Java or something.
Well, maybe you fixed your Java. I don't know. Try it again later and see if you can get them.
Well, I just tried the other one and it still didn't work.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know how they're put together because I didn't come up with these. Dr. Bryant did. Okay? So what we're going to do now that we got it in here, before you do anything, my question is there going to be an acceleration here? What do you think?
Yes.
Yes. Because sum of forces, you can give that another name, that can be net force. Anytime there's a net force, there's going to be an acceleration. So that, will there be an acceleration? The answer is yes. What direction? Same direction as the net force. You're absolutely right. So now you press go, and when you press go, you say you record the motion of the cart. You just describe what the cart is doing and how it's doing it. So I'm going to press go. Well, wait, I hit the wrong key. Sorry. I hit the wrong button on my computer. I'm pressing go. And what do you describe the speed?
Slowly gaining speed.
Okay. It started slowly, but then picked up speed. What does that mean? If it's changing speed,
accelerating.
It's accelerating. You've got it. So what you said before, that it would accelerate, yes it is, because it starts at zero speed and picks up to maybe 1.5, I don't know. It doesn't matter what that says there. It picks up, increases its speed. Okay? How does the speed change? I just said it. It went from zero to some positive speed. Well, in this case, I'd call it a negative speed because it's to the left. But that's okay. All right. Now let's go over here and drag a little red android to the knot. And when you get him near the knot, let him go. Okay? Your next question says, record the sum of forces and the direction. What's your sum of force?
Zero.
Okay. Of course, it has no direction if it's a zero sum, right? Because they balance each other out. So the direction, you could put none or whatever. The question is there going to be an acceleration? What do you think? What did I hear? No, because there's no net force. Okay, you're absolutely right. Okay, so let's, and there will be no direction for the acceleration either. So let's see what happens when we press go. What happened? It continued, it still moved to the left, but it didn't change its speed. Does having a zero acceleration mean you have no motion? No, it means you're not changing your speed. You can be on cruise control and you're not accelerating, right? You're just going at a constant speed. So even the second android here, the red one, isn't doing anything to change the speed. Okay? So what we'll do now is pull a second little android up. Isn't that what it says next? Oh,
yes.
And how did the speed change? We didn't answer that question. How did the speed change then when you put the first android up, the red android up? It didn't change the speed because you had zero acceleration. So what do you think, before I hit go here, what do you think is going to happen? You tell me. Say again? Okay, you think it's going to go to the right immediately, right? Let's see. No, it's going to the left, but what's about the speed?
It decreased.
It's decreasing, but now it's increasing to the right. Okay? Why? Because if it was going to the left, it's going to continue in that way until the net force pulls it the other way. Did we answer that question? When I pulled the little second android up, what was the net force? I forgot to do that one. Or did
it? No, we didn't answer it.
We did answer it?
We did not.
Did not. Okay, what was the net force? 50 to the right. Was there going to be an acceleration?
Yes.
Which direction?
Right. To the right.
And sure enough, there was. It didn't stop. It slowed it down to begin with. Then it stopped it and started pulling back to the right. Right?
Yes.
Okay. Now, did you record the motion of the cart? What did you see happening? Started moving to the... No, it started moving to the
left
and then slowed down, stopped, and started moving to the right, always accelerating to the right. Correct?
Yes.
Okay. Sorry, I left off some of the things. Let's now drag the second little blue android up to near his knot and let him get there. What do you think is going to happen here when I hit go? Oh, wait, first, before we do that, what's the sum of forces? Okay, which direction? No direction, okay? Do you think it's going to accelerate?
No.
So what does that mean about its motion? It's going to sit there?
Yeah.
Is that what you said?
Yes.
Oh, I think not. Because it was going at a certain speed, so when I hit go, it's going to continue at that speed, isn't it? but not going to change the speed. Why? An object in motion stays in motion unless it's acted on by an unbalanced force. This didn't have any unbalanced force. It's going to keep going to the right at the same speed. That was Newton's first law, wasn't it? Yay or nay?
Yeah,
I knew you liked his first law. Okay, we've done number four. Did you record the motion of the cart? Continued going to the right, didn't it? At the same speed, how does the speed change? It didn't. Right? Are y'all getting this?
All right.
So, let's go to the medium blue android. Drag him up to his knot. You can put on any knot you want to. I'm just going to put him there. Okay. Now, what's in that force? Sum of forces.
100 newton.
Which way?
To the left.
To the left. Okay. So, is there going to be an acceleration? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes, because there's a net force. Which way will the acceleration be?
To the left.
To the left. Okay, very good. Now, what do you think that's going to do to the speed? Remember, it was going to the right at that speed there. What's it going to start off at?
Increase it to the left.
Yes, it'll still be going to the right, but it's going to start decreasing that speed until it turns it. So let's see what happens. Oh, he did it. Okay. Oh, let's go a little further. Okay. Now, did you record the motion of the car? I didn't mean to hit this pause too soon. It started off to the right, slowed down, stopped, and then started going to the left. All that was an acceleration to the left because the net force is to the left. Okay? And it's sad. Aren't we at the top of the second page now? How did the speed change? How did you answer that? Yeah, slowed down to the right and then finally started, went to zero and started increasing to the left. Okay, very good. I think we're on page two now, aren't we?
Yes.
All right. Let's take the median red android, put him on his knot, or her, I don't know which it is. Okay. What's the sum of forces?
Zero.
Okay. No direction associated. Will there be acceleration? No. Why not? There's no net force. So what that's going to mean about the speed? Is it going to stop? No, because it had a speed. You see it? It's going to continue at that speed unchanged. Right? Let's see. Let's hit go. Oh my, it didn't budge, did it? Okay, so just record the motion of the cart. What would you say? Still going to the left at the same speed. How does the speed change? It doesn't. Right? All right. Say again.
Left.
Okay, correct, not right. Okay, very good. All right, you're ready for the big boy on the red side? All right, what's your net force?
150 newton.
Which way?
To the right.
Does that mean we're going to have an acceleration or not?
Yes.
Okay, which way?
To the right.
Okay, does that mean the cart's going to move to the right? Really? Watch it. Oh, it's not moving to the right. It's moving to the left. But what's it doing?
The speed is increasing, so it's moving to the right.
It decreased as it moved to the right. Yeah, it decreased going to the left and then stopped and then went back to the right and started increasing to the right. Okay? And how does the speed change? I think you just answered that. Started off to the left, went to zero, and then increased to the right. Okay, that means it was accelerating to the right. Even when the cart was going to the left, it was accelerating to the right because it was slowing down to the left and increasing to the right. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay, let's get big old blue big boy up there and see what happens. What's your net force? Anybody?
Zero.
Does that mean we're going to have any acceleration?
No.
No. So what do you expect the speed to do? It's going to hold steady, not increase, but not decrease, because it's not accelerating. Let's see if that's what happens. Doesn't change a bit, does it? Moves to the right, even though you got zero net force. If there's no external forces acting on it, the speed doesn't change. Newton's first law. An object in motion is going to stay in motion unless it's acted on by an unbalanced force. This had all balanced forces. It's going to keep going to the right at the same speed. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. Number 9 at the bottom, what is the relationship between the sum of forces and acceleration? What would you say? Is there a relationship between the sum of forces and acceleration? What you think? Yeah. Just think of Newton's second law. Force equals mass times acceleration. If there's a net force, it's going to accelerate in the same direction. Not the same magnitude, because the mass is involved there, but it will accelerate in the same direction of the net force. Always. Always. Okay? Say again? Was there a question? Okay. The tenth one. What is the relationship between the sum of forces to speed? Now that may have several answers. If the sum of forces is zero, what does that do to the speed?
It doesn't change.
It doesn't change. But if the sum of the net forces is, let's say, positive to the right, what can that do to the speed? Well, it depends. If the object was initially moving to the left, what does it change to what does it do to the speed?
It
decreases until it reaches zero, and then it increases to the right. So you can write down whatever you want to there. Make sure you understand what it's meaning. Okay, you can play around with this all you want to. And if you didn't get all the things done, play with it until you get them done. All you have to do is hit this yellow button, return, and they all go back to where they were to begin with. Except they don't go back to where they need to return to their place too. Okay? Now, why are they not moving? They did for me before. Okay. Let me see if some of this is in the way. Huh. I thought they were going to return too. Oh, wait. This button up here, I remember now. This gets it back to start. You see what I did? That little button over there that has a circle in it?
Yes.
That erases everything. Okay? So now you have to go back, and if you're going to do the same thing we just did, you have to go back and click sum of forces, values, and speed. Okay? And then you can start over and play with it from there. Any questions?
No.
Okay? Now, even if people miss today's doing this, they can probably hear most of the answers right there when I get this loaded on Screencast-O-Matic and loaded on Blackboard. I mean on YouTube, and then you can pull it back up. That's going to be late tonight or tomorrow sometime, because as soon as I log off here, I've got to go to a meeting that's already in progress, and once I finish that meeting, I've got another one at 6 o'clock, and once I finish that meeting, I may start be able to unload this. I'll eat some for sometime in there, but it's going to be really late before I get this loaded. Any questions before I let you go? Okay, do y'all need to stay in so you can talk with each other for a while?
No.
No? Okay, if not, then I'll shut down the whole meeting here. And I don't know where that's gone. Oh, let me do this. Y'all are going to have to pull it up on your own because I got to get out of this. So let me pull Kurt out of the way here. Y'all can't see what I'm doing, but I couldn't get to my icon. Okay. I'm going to close off this one. Close off this one. And close off this one. And screen sharing has stopped, so y'all can't see this. You only see me, poor thing. Okay. I'm going to shut this down. And it's okay to go on and end the meeting.
Yep.
All right. Enjoyed having you today. I'll look forward to seeing you on Thursday, okay? Okay, bring your friends. Get in touch with anyone that's missing. See if they can get here, okay? Let them know how to do it. One thing I'm going to try a little differently if I can do it all is I'm going to try to put it both as an announcement and as a message. Because some students said they were looking for announcements and I had moved it to message. I thought they were the same things, but I found out today they were different. So I'll start trying to do both. Okay? We'll see you then Thursday, okay? Bye-bye.